No country on earth incarcerates more of its people than the United States. In 1980, the country's prison population was about 150 per 100,000 adults. It has more than quadrupled since. About 2.3 million Americans are behind bars, as many prisoners as China and Russia combined. One out of 100 US citizens are incarcerated, and the nation houses about 25% of the world's prisoners, despite being home to less than 5% of the world's people. The US's prisons employ about 800,000 workers, which is more than the auto manufacturing industry. California's prisons are so overcrowded that the state is under a court order to reduce its inmate population. California already outsources prisoners as far away as Mississippi. Also, Hawaii houses about 1,700 inmates in an Arizona prison.
So there are 9.8 million human beings on planet Earth living inside of cages that we know of. In 2010, the US was home to about 309 million people, 4.5% of the world's total population, but housed 23% of the world's prisoners. So take a moment to think about what this means. It means we imprison more people than enormous autocratic countries like China. We imprison more people than Russia. Compared to the size of our population, our rate of imprisonment dwarfs our closest allies, like the United Kingdom, France, and Canada. The most unique feature of incarceration in America is the large and active role of our federal government. In most countries, crime is reacted to at the local or regional level, whereas the American government finances and legislates a significant portion of law enforcement at the national level. State governments still do their fair share of incarceration, though. California and Texas incarcerate more than other states, with over 171,000 inmates each. Florida is a close third with over 103,000 prisoners. But no single state locks up more people than the federal government, with over 208,000 inmates. Perhaps the nickname Land of the Free, Home of the Brave, should be updated. Though I suppose you need to be brave to endure the highest likelihood of incarceration the world has ever known.
However, according to the Bureau of Justice Statistics, the nation's prison population has decreased for the third year in a row. In 2012, the prison population decreased 1.7%. Conversely, federal incarcerations increased 0.7% in 2012. It is important to note that the Bureau's touted drop excludes prisoners who are being held before sentencing or those serving less than a year's sentence. Incarcerating all these people costs the US taxpayers about $55 billion a year. On average, it costs more than $25,000 to imprison a federal inmate for 1 year. Moreover, the money states spend on prisons has risen at 6 times the rate of spending on higher education in the past 20 years. For example, in 2011, California spent $9.6 billion on prisons compared to $5.7 billion on the UC system and state colleges. Since 1980, California has built one college campus and 21 prisons. In California, a college student costs the state about $8,667 per year. A prisoner there is about $45,000 a year. Furthermore, drug offenses account for almost 1 in 5 inmates in state prisons and half of those in federal prisons. Astonishingly, there is a drug arrest every 19 seconds in the US. In 2010, about 1.64 million people were arrested for drug violations. 4 out of 5 arrests were for possession, and almost half were possession of small amounts of cannabis.
The criminal justice system's expectation that incarceration will eliminate one's desire to continue to use drugs is a fallacy. The power and the profit of prohibition, in fact, provides for illegal drugs in many prisons. If we can't keep drugs out of our prisons, ladies and gentlemen, how on earth are we going to keep them out of our neighborhood? Our current drug war mission is to create a drug-free society, and we're expected to continue paying for it until that happens. We're here to tell you today, coming from the front lines, it's not going to happen. It has been said by this administration, the drug war is over. The war is not over. It's still in the budget. It's stronger than it ever was. And it is still on the police logs of your community, and it's still on the court docket around the country.
In Canada, the number of prisoners grew by 17% between 2006 and 2011, while the country's general population only increased 5.9%. More than 35,000 people are locked up on an average day in Canada, and there are more than 15,100 inmates in Canada's federal prisons. The number of prisoners in provincial jails also doubled from 1,147 in 2005 to 2,253 in 2012. More than half of these inmates are in overcrowded Manitoba jails. What's more, double bunking, where two or sometimes three prisoners are shoved in a cell made for one, increased 27% between 2011 and 2012. Since the Conservative Party came to power in 2006, arrests for cannabis possession have similarly jumped 41%. From 2006 to 2011, police reported more than 405,000 pot-related arrests. Moreover, cannabis offenses accounted for a record 78,000 arrests in 2011, which was 69% of all drug offenses. As a result of the so-called tough-on-crime tactics by the Conservative government, nearly half of Ontario's jails are overcrowded, hitting a six-year high as the province struggles with an increase of inmates who have yet to stand trial. On an average day last year, 14 of the province's 29 jails held more prisoners than they were designed for. This increase is being met with the construction of a major correctional complex in southwestern Ontario, as well as a 1,650-bed super jail in Toronto.
Anywhere they've been tried, mega prisons have been disaster. Yeah. They've left states like California nearly bankrupt with soaring crime rates and no way back. While the rest of the world recoils from the mistake, the Prime Minister is bent on repeating it. Before we could turn back, while the Prime Minister is in the United States, will he tour the mega prisons he's trying to import? Will he sit down with Republican lawmakers who founded these ideas and listen to what a complete, total and utter failure they've been? Will they at least look at the example they're trying to emulate? So let's try a simple question and see if the member can answer it. Name one jurisdiction, anyone, anywhere in the world where this stuff has been tried and worked. Because I'll tell you, anywhere I've looked, it's been a complete disaster.
Yeah. Honorable Parliament, Secretary to the Minister of Public Safety.
Well, with all due respect, Mr. Speaker, I don't think I would insult any of our neighbors or our allies around the world, but we have been to other countries, and the member opposite was part of the committee that went to Norway, and we heard about recidivism. We heard about people that are back in the prisons up to 30 times. I don't think his approach will work, but at the same time, Mr. Speaker, we have a Made in Canada approach that will work, that Canadians understand, and that Canadians are asking us and are supporting us in it.
According to Craig McBride, spokesman for Corrections Minister Madeleine Moyeux, more than 1,500 new inmates are expected within 2 years. Across Canada, the federal government is spending $600 million to build 2,700 new cells in the coming years.
We'll increasingly see the prisons becoming the warehouse for those who will not and cannot be met somewhere else, and they'll be increasingly brutalizing warehouses.
That warehousing is already happening, and the head of Corrections Canada knows it, says Correctional Ombudsman Howard Sapers.
The Correctional Service's sort of worst-case scenario projection right now is that about one in three cells will be double bunked.
Inmates double and even triple bunked in some jails. A prison system bursting at the seams, and a new bill that will turn the pressure up another notch.
The most controversial enforcement change recently implemented by the Harper government is mandatory minimum sentences, a policy that was one of the primary catalysts for the U.S.'s massive prison population. Mandatory minimums do not merely target violent criminals or major drug traffickers. Every year in the U.S., mandatory minimums result in the lengthy incarceration of thousands of low-level offenders who could be given shorter sentences at an annual savings of several hundred million dollars. Based on events in the U.S. and other nations, mandatory minimums in Canada will likely increase prosecution and incarceration costs, leaving less money for rehabilitation programs, continue to cause overcrowding in prisons, remove judges' discretion, forcing them to apply blanket sentences regardless of circumstances, limit the use of alternate sentencing measures applied to Aboriginal offenders, disproportionately punish small-time drug offenders while having a limited effect on drug producers, organized crime bosses, and large-scale traffickers, harshly punish young offenders, stigmatizing them for life, continue to disproportionately affect blacks and aboriginals, lead to more trials and parole hearings, and turn non-violent offenders into violent or repeat criminals. In addition, mandatory minimums violate provisions of the Charter of Rights and Freedoms and will cost Canadian taxpayers millions of additional dollars per year.
American advocacy group made up of police officers, judges, and policy advisors are advising the Harper government to not pass Bill C-10 legislation that includes mandatory minimum sentences for drug offenses.
Joining us now in Washington is Eric Sterling, spokesman for the Law Enforcement Against Prohibition. Eric, your group is advocating that the conservative government in this country not enact this new crime legislation. You cite problems that happen in the U.S. as a result. What kind of issues did you have in the states with this zero-tolerance approach?
Until 2005, Texas had the highest rate of incarceration in the world, with fully 1 in 20 of all its residents locked up. In the 1990s, when these scenes were shot by the CBC, Texas prisons filled to bursting. Most prisoners didn't even have cells, just a cubicle and a bunkhouse crammed with 30 men at a time. Yet the crime statistics were worse than those in other states. But then things changed. Ever since 2005, things have changed so much that every week at the courthouse in Dallas,
license broke.
You can see a Texas judge hugging criminals. Even giving them medals for graduating from drug treatment. The judge says the old ways just didn't work.
We spent a lot of money, billions of dollars, building prisons and housing prisoners, and it didn't get us anywhere. You fund treatment and you fund aftercare and you fund programs that will deal with that on a long-term basis, that you avoid sending thousands of people to prison.
It sounds expensive.
It's less expensive.
Tell me about that.
Well, we have data. This program that we run here, for example, we had a university do a cost-benefit analysis. When every dollar we spend is $9.34 in avoided criminal justice costs.
Other studies agree that putting someone in drug treatment costs about one-tenth of what it costs to put them in prison.
Well, the first thing you learn in a Texas courtroom is that the popular image of tough Texas justice is out of date. Yes, for years they built more prisons and they stuffed them full, but then they got the bill. And Texas, yes, even Texas, reversed course.
What they did was put fewer people in jail. Over 5 years, the rate of incarceration dropped by 9%. At the same time, the FBI says the crime rate dropped by nearly 13%. And they did that by spending on treatment instead.
In the United States, even medical marijuana growers have faced sentences of 85 years under the mandatory drug sentencing laws. In the past, the American Legislative Exchange Council was a driving force behind tougher sentences in the U.S. But on August 5th of this year, the conservative corporate-backed group adopted legislation that would reduce compulsory minimum sentences for a range of drug and other crimes. An increasing number of judges, prosecutors, and others are criticizing mandatory minimums, including Attorney General Eric Holder, who called for sweeping, systematic changes to the American judicial system on August 12th, urging a frank and constructive dialogue about the need to reform a broken system. He even labeled mandatory minimums draconian and asked Congress to reform a system which can breed disrespect for itself. He also said mandatory minimums have resulted in unduly harsh sentences and disparities that do not reflect our principles of federal prosecution. Long sentences for low-level nonviolent drug offenses do not promote public safety, deterrence, and rehabilitation. The ballooning U.S. prison population is also assisted by three strikes laws. Beginning in the early 1990s, states began to enact mandatory sentencing laws for repeat criminal offenders, which are invoked when they commit their third offense. By 2003, more than half the states and the federal government had enacted three strikes laws. California includes nonviolent felonies, like drug crimes, in their version of the law. Three strikes laws have since been toned down in 25 states, where every inmate is required to serve at least 85% of their sentence.
But PORAC has contributed $100,000 to defeating a ballot initiative called Prop 36 that's aimed at requiring the third strike to be a serious felony before triggering the automatic 25-year-to-life sentence.
The people had thought that when we voted for that law that we were going to be putting away serious violent criminals like murderers and rapists and child molesters.
We believe that three strikes is working. We saw an immediate reduction in the crime rate in California shortly after 1994 when it was passed and implemented the first time.
It is true that crime has declined since three strikes went into effect in 1994, but that decline has been seen nationwide and in states that don't have the same prison overcrowding problems as California does. 327 California inmates received their third strike from a petty theft. More than 3,500 are serving a 25-to-life sentence for a nonviolent, non-serious crime. And more than 1,300 of those are incarcerated for a nonviolent drug offense. The California State Auditor's Office estimates the cost of incarcerating these nonviolent criminals under the three strikes guidelines at $7.5 billion. But PORAC and CCPOA both say that more prisons and more prison guards are the ultimate solution.
With such an influx in prisoners in the United States, private prison companies are picking up the slack. And the more inmates they house, the more money they make. 10% of U.S. prisons are privately operated and hold about 130,000 people, or 8% of American inmates. That's almost double the prisoners from 10 years ago. Unlike their public counterparts, private prisons are accountable to shareholders, investors, and hedge funds, not just the taxpayers. The two biggest prison companies, the GEO Group and the Corrections Corporation of America, CCA, accrue more than $3 billion a year between them. CCA, the largest, imprisons about 80,000 inmates in 67 facilities, while the GEO Group operates 95 prisons internationally. Furthermore, these companies are not classified as correctional facilitators. They consider themselves real estate investment trusts to limit corporate tax liability. CCA and the GEO Group make about 40% of their revenue from the federal government and are exempt from paying federal taxes. The CCA's annual shareholder reports over the past few years show an aggressive business plan based on building prison beds and contracting them to government authorities, sometimes with decades-long contracts mandating minimum occupancy rates as high as 90%. Profits, after lining the pockets of shareholders, are used to create more beds and to lobby state and federal agencies to deliver more prisoners to fill them. CCA alone is currently building 10,000 new beds to meet expected demand. The prison industry also makes money contracting cheap prison labor to private companies, including Starbucks, Boeing, Victoria's Secret, McDonald's, and the U.S. military. Prison laborers earn between 93 cents and $4 a day and don't require benefits, making them very inexpensive workers. One company that contracts out prison labor is Federal Prison Industries. The company made more than $900 million in revenue last year. One of the main reasons for the surge in private prisons is the alleged monetary savings. However, Policy Matters Ohio demonstrated that selling a prison to a private company could cost a state between $8 and $15 million more than traditional corrections. Now, U.S. private prison firms are targeting Canada for fresh opportunities as more states look to scale back their reliance on them. The GEO Group and Management and Training Corporation have been lobbying various government departments in Ottawa. Correctional Services Canada, which oversees federal prisons, says they may consider partnerships with private firms to provide basic institutional services such as cleaning and food preparation. Because the main goal of private prisons is to increase revenue like any other business, the resulting facilities are often violent, filthy, and understaffed. For example, in a GEO Group prison in Mississippi, a culture of corruption and violence, including staff setting up fights between inmates and betting on the outcome, was exposed. In Canada, the violence is exacerbated by the lack of jobs, programs, and education for inmates. At the front line of the drug war are the DEA in the United States and the RCMP in Canada, as well as state, provincial, and local law enforcement. In the U.S., a secretive DEA unit was recently reported to be funneling information from intelligence intercepts, wiretaps, informants, and a massive database of telephone records to authorities across the U.S. to help them launch criminal investigations of Americans. The unit of the DEA that distributes the information is called the Special Operations Division, or SOD. Two dozen agencies comprise the unit, including the FBI, CIA, NSA, IRS, and the Department of Homeland Security. It originated originated in 1994 to combat Latin American drug cartels and has since grown from dozens of employees to hundreds. Disturbingly, law enforcement agents are directed to conceal how SOD investigations truly begin, not only from defense lawyers, but also from prosecutors and judges. Agents are instructed to use normal investigative techniques to recreate the information provided by SOD. Two senior DEA officials defended the program, saying the recreation of an investigative trail is not only legal, but a method that is used almost daily.
This is a practice that some experts say violates a defendant's constitutional right to a fair trial. And without knowing exactly how an investigation began, defense lawyers are working with their hands tied behind their backs. It's close to impossible for the defendant to know what evidence to revisit and which potential sources for review. Now, all of which could reveal mistakes, bias, witnesses, or entrapment on the part of the prosecution.
So I think any constitutional system that is supposed to support civil liberty should allow citizens, when they're charged for a crime, to actually view the evidence presented against them and know how it was acquired. But this doesn't allow for that at all. And as you reported, agents from the DEA are encouraged to, in effect, just sort of make up or to recreate the evidence against people being charged with crimes, and that should worry people.
In Canada, the Conservative government has begun the execution of several initiatives that could give US FBI and DEA agents the ability to pursue suspects in Canada. The first step was the formation of cross-border pilot projects allowing Canadian and American agents in each other's waters. Second, Bill C-38 now mandates that is permanently legal for U.S. agents to be certified as police in Canadian waters. The final steps yet to come are cross-border policing on land and U.S. aerial surveillance over Canada, which has not been ruled out by the Conservative government. One current example of this U.S.-Canada enforcement partnership is the case of Mark Emery, nicknamed the Prince of Pot, Canadian businessman and political activist who created Cannabis Culture magazine. He was also a world leader in cannabis seed retail until the DEA and Canadian law enforcement arrested him in Canada for selling cannabis seeds to Americans. Emery was extradited by the Canadian government in May 2010 and sentenced to 5 years in a Mississippi prison. However, the DEA later admitted Emery was targeted because of his role in cannabis activism and financing the movement. In July of this year, Mark Emery's application to be transferred back to Canada for the remainder of his prison sentence was approved by the U.S. Department of Justice. While the United States appears to be moving away from strict drug laws, including mandatory minimum sentences, the Canadian government has ignored the lessons learned by our southern neighbors. A nation once known for its forward-thinking, liberalized laws has gone backwards. When it comes to cannabis, Canadians can at least take solace in the likelihood of the government following the US when pot is inevitably made legal in the states. Furthermore, depending on the outcome of Canada's 2015 federal election, drug laws in the nation could do another U-turn if the Liberals manage to win a majority government.
One could argue